Samacharya If out of foolishness an ordinary person thus imitates such behavior, he will simply destroy himself, just as a person who's not Rudra would destroy himself if he tried to drink an ocean of poison. Lord Shiva, or Rudra, once drank an ocean of poison, and the result was that an attractive blue mark appeared on his neck. But if we were to drink even a drop of such poison, we would die immediately, just as we should not imitate this pastime of Shiva's, we should not imitate Lord Krishna's activities with the gopis. We should clearly understand that while Lord Krishna certainly descends to demonstrate religious principles, he also descends to demonstrate that he is God, and we are not. That also must be demonstrated. The Lord enjoys with his internal potency and thus attracts us to the spiritual platform. We should not try to imitate Krishna, for we will suffer severely. Om Jnana Timurandasya Jnandana Sabakaya Shakshurunitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Shri Chaitanya Manovistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kalamayam Tadati Svakalandikam Vandiham Sri Guru Sri Yuta Pada Kamalam
Shri Gurum Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sagnaravratam Vitantam Sajivam Sarvetam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sagana Dalita Sivisakandhitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindha Dina Vandha Jagat Pate Bhupesha Bhupita Kanta Radha Kanta Mostate Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vishavana Sute Devi Pranamami Yadriye Vanchakalpatrubhyaccha Kripasidubhyaccha Patitanam Panebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadha Sri Vasudhi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
So in this this chapter the Rasa Dance is described. And the Rasa Dance is a completely transcendental activity where Krishna is transcending social etiquette, by social etiquette, to get involved with the wife of someone else is the most abominable. In the Vedic literature, it is even said that a man whose wife is in this way exploited by another man, that man has the right to kill the exploiter without any karmic reaction whatsoever. Of course, you still may get in trouble with the government. And therefore, we cannot recommend to take such actions. And in the Vaishnav community, we have a different attitude. We also transcend. And in the Vaishnavas are basing their whole life on forgiveness. If we have no ksama, no forgiveness, then where is the question? Of ever being merciful. It's impossible. And being merciful is the central quality of a Vaishnava, of compassion. So we have to forgive. But that doesn't mean that we may forgive, but doesn't always mean that we forget. So we can still keep an eye. If someone has put his hands in the safe and filled his pockets, we might forgive, but we'll never give him the key again. That's for sure. Make sure we'll keep him at a distance. Like that. Anyway, so back to the transcendental activities of Krishna. Krishna is... It is very interesting that Krishna is transcendental to morality, not only transcendental to worldly morality, but he even is transcendental to Vedic morality, even to the principles of Dharma. Because whatever Krishna does that makes morality, that is, whatever Krishna does, that is perfect. So Krishna is stealing, and so Krishna is getting involved with other men's wives and engages in amorous pastimes. Of course, who is anyone to claim anyone as his? Say, this is my wife, my land, my house, my car, mine. Who are you? Who are you to claim anything as yours? Even your body, you can't even claim that as yours.
Right.
Although you may say it's my body, but you have no control over it. And when it decides to do things you don't want it to do, it does it anyway, just on its own. And when it's the end, and there's nothing you can do about it. Mm. So in that way, we are not the proprietor of anything. And Krishna is the proprietor. He is the supreme proprietor. Therefore, even the wives belong to Krishna. Everyone belongs to Krishna first. This is transcendental understanding. Krishna is bhaktaram yagyatapasam sarvadukam heshwaram suridam sarvabhutanam gitvam santibhishti. Krishna is the supreme enjoyer. Everything is meant for his enjoyment. Nothing is meant for our enjoyment. Krishna was not relating to young married gopis as a man who was trying to fulfill his own lusty desires. Krishna was responding to the love in their hearts. Krishna was reciprocating with that transcendental love. We tend to see everything from a perspective of sexuality. So we think that if Krishna is getting involved with these ladies, some lusts might drive the whole thing. But Krishna operates on a different platform. Krishna, he operates on the platform of pure love. And so, it is the love of the gopis that captures Krishna. It is the love of the gopis that makes Krishna accept them as his wives. And when he steals their clothes while they were bathing naked in the river in a remote place with ladies only, and he sneaked up there, which was again against social etiquette. There are such places in India where ladies take baths and no man goes there. Everybody knows. As soon as you see a bunch of ladies bathing, there's a man, turn around and walk away. That is social etiquette. But Krishna went there and hid himself and stole the clothes from the bank of the river and hung them high in a tree and made the gopis. Yeah, the gopis are saying, oh, Krishna, what are you doing? Please, you know, like, don't steal our clothes. I mean, Krishna, please give us our clothes back. You know, I mean, Krishna, we're freezing in the water and we have to come out. And Krishna made them come out naked. They were forced, they were cold. And then Krishna said, how could you take bath naked? That was an offense. You should beg forgiveness for your offense and just fold your hands in prayer. Right? And in that way, he could see their full bodies. So Krishna, but deep down in their hearts, there was a desire to be accepted by Krishna as their husband, or as his wives, and Krishna as their husband. And so Krishna reciprocated with that desire. And the external activities, right, of embracing and so on, these are all secondary to the matter of the heart. It is the heart that is primary. In this world, it's sometimes the flesh is primary, and if there is a heart, it comes sort of after, or it's not exactly clear when it's the heart and when it's the flesh. That is the situation in the material world. So we must be careful to project our judgment upon the transcendental activities of Krishna. The rasa dance, or Krishna's rasika exchanges, which do not just take place by the dancing arrangement on the bank of the Yamuna, but which are the underlying principle in Krishna's daily pastimes. Because although Krishna is Sri Krishna Akarsani, it is stated the characteristics of pure devotional service in the Nectar of Devotion, this chapter, which describes these characteristics of pure devotional service. And there it is mentioned that Krishna is Sri Krishna Akarsani, that he becomes captured, he becomes attracted by devotional service. The more Krishna becomes attracted by all devotional service, but Krishna only becomes fully attracted by pure devotional service, and then more attracted by the unalloyed pure devotional service of the gopis in Vrindavan, and the most attracted to the unalloyed pure devotional service of Srimati Radharani. In this verse, we are having a warning that we should never imitate the behavior of ruling personalities. We should not imitate Krishna in his pastimes, and we should also not imitate Srimati Radharani. We should also not think that we are a great devotee. Sometimes we see that a neophyte pushes himself up front, right, and directly goes to Krishna. But the more advanced devotee has learned to live in the truth. And when we learn, when we live in the truth, we begin to acknowledge that we are only tiny, significant little jivas. We are tiny, little, insignificant jivas who are prone to fall prey to the illusory energy. Now, this muyanti yat suryaha is what I want to highlight from this verse. Everything has its origin in Krishna. Krishna is all-knowing, all-pervading. He is at the same time independent. And even great demigods, who are much more powerful than we are, who are much more pious than we are, who are by nature in goodness, and we are by nature in passion, having taken birth on this planet, and a lot of ignorance as well from the age of Kali. And if you combine all that, so by even the great demigods are prone to fall prey under illusion. At the end of the verse, the image is painted of the deer running after false water in the desert. It's on reflection, you know, Fata Morgana. And there goes the deer, and bye-bye, dear one. That is the end. Die somewhere in the dry desert. Recently, I was in Amsterdam to get a visa for India, and it happened to be the day of gay pride. And Amsterdam is a serious place when it comes to these things. And but there was a hurry now, and we went on that hurry now. And yes, most people were just there for the party. But then, you know, because the Dutch people are always ready for a party. It doesn't matter which one, as long as it's a party. But, you know, it was very crowded, and every once in a while we saw some same-sex couples intertwined in some sort of holding on to each other. And yeah, that image came to my mind of the deer running into the desert, and thinking, why? This is just another way of running into the desert. And there was a stage program, and I heard someone say, "And our battle is not over." Okay, but what are you fighting for? Fighting for an illusion. There will be no happiness. There will be no fulfillment. So that is material life. Muyanti et Surya. So that is us. Yes. This way, that way, it doesn't matter. We are prone to run after illusions. That is the case. So one who becomes situated in truth is a very rare person in this world. Most people live a lie. No, I'm happy. Yeah. Oh, it's a beautiful world. And it's a beautiful world. Yes, it is. But, you know, I mean, early morning, it was a beautiful bird with beautiful colored feathers sitting in a tree, and I just happened to see it. I'm looking out of the window, going like, wow, wow, beautiful bird. Next moment, my beautiful bird swoops down and swallows a whole mouse. I go, whoa, a whole mouse. And yes, I've seen so many ghastly things. In India, you see things a bit more blatant, and since I was there a long time, there was a dead dog lying on the road, as can be in India. No one removed it until a hawk came. And in one bite, these hawk walking, in one bite, he ate half the dog. It ate half the dog. In one bite. Whoa. Half the dog in one bite. It was, what shall I say? Ever since that time, I am careful with these hawks. Could be my leg. Half a dog in one bite. Okay. Anyway, we can speak for 10 minutes about the gruesome things in the material world, but I think 10 seconds is enough, or 1 minute. And I think it's enough. Let's keep it sweet. So one who lives in the truth, that is the proper way to live. It is said, tattva visargo janataka viplavo yasmin pratislogan abadavati apinamanya natasya yasun kitariya shimbanti ginanti giyanti sarvaha. This Srimad Bhagavatam is heard and sung by men who are thoroughly honest. They are sarva. They are living in the truth. And take it as it is. So yes, one who lives in the truth must immediately recognize his own limitations. We're very limited, very small and insignificant in comparison to the great forces that surround us. Time. What are we going to do about time? Nothing. No cream will help. Sorry. Time will strike. Yes. Right. Time takes everything away. First time gives. Growing bigger. Growing more powerful. Oh yes, yes. Can't wait. Yes. Growing bigger and bigger until you are the biggest. The biggest point in your life, huge, enormous. And then start to dwindle, shrivel up. Gradually lose it, and losing it.
He's losing it.
Little by little, losing it, losing it. Can still fake it, but for how long? So we can appreciate our limitations very, very much. And an honest person is conscious of that and remembers that. And that will bring about humility. It is there where we find humility, in honesty, naturally, because who are we? Then we also appreciate, what is my bhakti? Otherwise it's, out of the way, I am here to pray. It's my devotional service. But what is my devotional service? It's poor, a poor offering. My names, the names I chant, broken names, my kirtan. Ho ho, what is it? What are we chanting for? How deep are we in our dedication? Nothing compared to Srimad Radharani. Radharani said, I've decided to give up sleeping. Okay, I haven't. I didn't sleep so well last night, and I sort of felt sorry for myself. I didn't sleep well. Now, sleeping, right? Yeah. She just gave it up. Why did she give it up? Because she said, sleep also influences me to forget Krishna. So I'll forget it. I'm not going to forget Krishna, so I won't sleep. Okay. Yeah. And you say, well, what can you do, you know? And I don't sleep. What can you do? And you may forget Krishna, but yeah, I can't help it, you know? It's not my fault. I have to sleep. But that's not the way Radharani sees it, because she has just a bit more bhakti, a bit more devotion than we have. So here we are, okay. We're falling short again. And there is a long list of personalities we can compare ourselves to, and next to them we are dwarfed again and again. Even if we look around the room, we see that others are doing so many things, and what are we doing? We are dwarfed. So, this is good. This humility is required to approach Krishna, to approach the Rasa dance. If we are not humble, how can we approach the Rasa dance? Only when we realize I am not qualified. Yes, only when we realize I have no devotion. Only when we realize I am just whatever little service I'm doing because it's been given to me. They kindly gave to me, somehow or other. Devotees, they kindly gave to me. They gave me the book, I didn't want it. I didn't really want it. But they kind of, I don't know, they were so convincing. I mean, or sort of to get rid of him. Yeah. I took it, you know, okay, I didn't read it for years at least, and one day I read every book in the book cover, and okay, well, I guess I never read that one, maybe I'll look at it. And then you read it, and you think, well, okay, it's not so bad actually, although, at the same time, a bit too much supreme personality of Godhead. Such a mouthful. Yeah, the Krishna book, read it in, they got it before I joined. Supreme Personality of Godhead, every three lines. Too much. Yeah. It took time to get used to all that, to get over that. I had something to overcome. Quite a bit to overcome, actually, in relation to Krishna consciousness. Have I overcome it now? After so many years, they hung attributes around my neck, they tied tulsi around my neck, hung a Brahmin thread around my shoulder, they gave me devotional dresses, they gave me a new haircut, had to get used to it. Anyhow, there it is. It always grows back. That's the nature. The nature of everything material, it always grows back. My desires also grow back. My conditioning also grows back. Did it ever leave? Or did it just go underground? Falgu Vairagya. If you go to Gaya, there is the famous Falguna River in Gaya. So I went there, came to the river, no water. Gaya is super hot. I mean, if you thought Radhadesh is hot these days, nothing compared to Gaya. Bihar, the plains of Bihar, is it hot? Garam, 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 bahut, jada garam. Too much hot. It is too much hot. It is too much hot. So I thought I'd go for a dip in the river. Come to the river, no water. No water. But then local people told, no, no, there is water. You dig 1 foot, you find the water. It's an underground river. Whoa, underground river. We don't have those in Holland. Underground river. It was just... So the Falgu Vairagya means we're giving up all our attachments, we become detached, but under the surface this attachment still remains, because only if we become attached to serving Krishna will the other things become insignificant. Only then. Well, in the beginning it's a lot of hard work before you become attached. But then gradually become attached. It is said, Gopyatama Bhayat Kamsu Dvesas Chidnyayam Ripa Vrishnya Sambandat Yuyam Bhakti Vayam Vivo. It is stated that the gopis, by their lusty desires, Kamsa, by his fear, the Vrishnis, by their family relationship, and we, the ordinary aspiring devotees, by hard work can we attain the mercy of Krishna. By hard work in devotional service. So yeah, that is our path. There is no way around it. No way around making an effort. Whatever that work is. It is said, collecting jewels from the mines of the scripture. It doesn't come automatically. One has to really get into it. Go through the mental barriers that, in everything, we have mental barriers, again and again. Sometimes we see a devotee who is advanced and who seems to be, who starts a kirtan and immediately it goes deep. Doesn't need to sort of take half an hour to crank up the old machine and to sort of get from the external into the internal immediately. That is due to Purvarak. That is due to previous attachment that came about in extensive devotional service. Because devotional service is done for Krishna, right? There is no question. There is agyata sukriti, unknown devotional service. But agyata sukriti, unknown performed devotional service, it even gives people a taste, but then it matures, and then it comes to a point where we consciously choose for it. Yes, I want to do this. That is where devotional service can really start to flourish, when we consciously choose for it. The agyata sukriti gets all the time interrupted here and there, and it's a little bit here, a little bit there, and that builds up over time. I always say to the book distributors that the one who says no today is the one who will say yes tomorrow, because he became purified by having the opportunity to get in the book, isn't it? So each time there's a contact, gets purified. So maybe he has to be say no 100 times and then say yes. So don't worry. The ones that don't buy tomorrow are the ones that buy tomorrow. Yes, that's how it works. Agyata sukriti. But no. We are not interested now in agyata sukriti. Now we want to embrace devotional service. Now we want to immerse ourselves in devotional service. Now we want to dive into this bhakti rasamrita sindhu, into this ocean of transcendental mellows. That is now. But then, as we are trying, we find resistance is there, reluctance is there, old habits die hard, some things are just hard to do. And we get lazy, it's like... cutting corners, and so on. So, at present, as we are facing so many anarthas, endeavor is required. But that endeavor is not just a matter of, and then you get a reward. No, what happens is because devotional service is done for Krishna, and because we are meditating on Krishna, and because we are serving Him, attachment develops, because Krishna is attractive, He's all attractive. So attachment develops, and as the attachment becomes deeper, then our determination grows. And from when attachment has grown, then nistha develops, firm determination. And in nistha, one has finally come to the point where we are really willingly submitting ourselves. Manmana bhava manbhakto majayimam namasku. Then we really bow down, right? Not just externally, but also our will. Then we give up our independence and try to really live the way Krishna wants us to live. But it takes quite some time to get there. There's a long time in devotional service where there's reluctance. We reluctantly get up in the morning. We are coming into Mangalarti. We bow down before the deities. The man go flat on the ground. It's hard to get back up. The first obeisances can last a long time. Especially in Radhadesh, in the winter, the floor is warm. Underfloor heating. Oh, is it good to lie down on that floor? Very attractive. Long obeisances. Get up. Yes. Reluctant. We wake up in the morning in an intimate embrace with our pillow. Oh, pillow. How I love you. No. Oh, I can't let go. So who are we to turn to the Rasadevas? But the final verse in this chapter is, I'm going to read that to you now, is saying that even although it is vikritam vrajavadubhiridam chadishno sadam vito nushin yat atavarna yit jaha bhaktim param bhagavati pratilabja kamam nidrogam asvapahi notya chirinadiraha. Anyone who faithfully hears or describes the Lord's playful affairs with the young gopis of Vrindavan will attain the Lord's pure devotional service. Then he will quickly become sober and conquer lust, the disease of the heart. So this is what we are doing right now. We are studying this chapter with our lack of qualification, but for our purification, and so that gradually, by hearing about the great and pure devotional service, our determination grows a little bit to make an effort, that then our attachment to Krishna will grow, and then that naturally our effort increases and we become a bit more spontaneous in our desire to serve Krishna. And so we become fixed in nistha. And then we embrace the process of devotional service and we get more and more taste until that taste covers the whole surface of our consciousness. And then it goes deep and becomes deep attachment, a shakti, and then that becomes so relishable, it becomes ecstasy, bhav, and that is like the ray of one ray of sunshine, of the full blast of Krishna praying. When everything is inspiring. At that stage, everything is just perfect. Well, yeah, right now we can philosophically try to remind ourselves everything is perfect. Everything is arranged by Krishna, but we don't feel it like that. We don't feel it like that at all. So it's simply preaching to ourselves. Preaching and preaching to ourselves again and again, reminding ourselves, yes, Everything is Krishna's arrangement. It's perfect.
It's perfect. Oh no, it's perfect that it also is a painkiller. And then there's a dentist. Oh, fix this now.
Some weeks ago I had an issue with urinary obstruction. I couldn't go. And I had to. And it was increasing. And I was blowing up. And I made it to the doctor. And they put some tube and I managed to get it out. And never in my life I thanked somebody so heartfelt. I said, thank you so much. Whew. Really? Yeah, not so easy to accept everything as perfect. Not so easy. Praying about you. Not so easy to be completely transcendental. Not so easy to be like that Vasudev the leper who had worms in his body and a worm fell out. He picked it up and put it back. Because after all, that was the worm's foot. I mean, who would be that? So yes, this Krishna consciousness. Still a long way to go. Still a long way to go. And if humility, if we don't embrace humility, if we don't preach to ourselves about humility, and if we don't embrace honesty and admit our flaws, then we carry this pride with us for years. And even if we get attached to Krishna, we're still proud. And it will clash. It will clash. It will clash. And Krishna will smash. Either become voluntarily humble or get smashed. Welcome to the material world. This is the principle of Purna Musik Bhav, right? It's like be a mouse again. It translates as get smashed, right? Yes, so it's up to us what we want. Be humble. Learn to be humble. Try to be humble. Admit that even then you're still not humble. Or keep your head low or get smashed. I'm sorry to put it so bluntly, but that is the way it is in this material world. That is what Krishna is doing with the conditioned souls. He's making them humble. And then he tries to increase everyone's love. So he does these things side by side. He tries to increase everyone's love for him. But unless we are humble, it will be difficult. Therefore, with a materialistic person, the focus is on making them humble. And there still may be an attempt to increase the love. And with the devotees, as they're becoming more humble, the focus shifts towards increasing the love in the hearts of the devotees, the love of God. So yes, we are now reading about these amazing transcendental pastimes that are pure and uncontaminated, and there is no lust in the hearts of all those who are involved. And how is it possible? No selfishness. Everything is perfectly selfless. The gopis are enjoying. They are enjoying when Krishna dances with them on the banks of the Yamuna. So is that not selfish? Is there not a little tinge of selfishness? They're enjoying. No, they're enjoying that Krishna is enjoying to provide this enjoyment.
Yes, it is enjoyment. They enjoy the enjoyment, but the core of it is that Krishna is providing it for their pleasure. And that he does out of love, and that is what they're enjoying. And then, as they're enjoying being ladies, they are at the same time trying to manipulate his feelings and to increase his love very expertly. Mm. And so, there is not a grain of selfishness in the whole exchange. How is it possible? Difficult to understand, but we are approaching this now. We reflect, we think about it. We don't know what selflessness is. We don't know. We don't know. We can only try to approach it in great humility and learn what real selflessness is, and gradually try to understand it better. So in this way, we are studying now the most intimate part of the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Thank you very much. Any questions? Any comments?
Once we had a discussion about Shiva and Shiva and Chakra and something like this, and you said to me, this is not your meditation. And since then, I asked myself, what really is your meditation? And what are you?
We had a discussion about Shiva Tattva.
But when
I said it's not our meditation, I meant Shiva Tattva is there is Sadashiva. He is residing on the spiritual side of the Viraja River, the river that separates the spiritual and material world. Then, that Sadashiva, when Lord Mahavishnu, during the night of Brahma, when the material energy is not manifest, Mahavishnu glances on the pradana, the potential of the material world. Sadashiva Shambhu becomes that glance. When Sadashiva, and he carries the living entities into the material world and places them. The pradana becomes active, the three modes of material nature become active. And Sadashiva, who somehow or other gets in touch with the material energy, transformed dada, yatada divikara vishesha yogurt, like yoga, milk into yoga and all that. Right? And he becomes Rudra, the demigod Shiva, whose abode is on the material side of the Viraja River and his Kalas. So there are two Shivas, the Sada Shiva on the spiritual side, and who's always meditating on Lord Sandarshan. So when we look at Sada Shiva, Sada Shiva is part of the bigger picture. The bigger picture of Krishna. Natasyakaryam karanam savijate. How Krishna is the cause of this universe, and how, although he has no work to do, everything goes on by his will through his energies and his expansion. So we see Sadashiva is ultimately an expansion of Krishna. And we see, so it's not our business to meditate on Lord Shiva. It is not even our business to meditate on Lord Mahavishnu. It is not our business to meditate on Lord Sankarshan. It's our business to meditate on Krishna. And all the others in relationship to Krishna. Lord Shiva, ya Vaishnavanam yata shambhu, yes. All others, ekulishvaro sarva bricha, yarayacha tektarakecha bricha, all. There's one Supreme Lord, all others are independent. We have ekantamanasa. We are just focused on Krishna. Kechi kevalai bhaktaya. Vasudeva Parayana, absorbed in Vasudeva. Vasudeva. Krishna, Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Krishna, 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 Krishna. Haridas, have you finished your rounds already? Enjoy with me. Come, I'm beautiful. Yes, I will when I'm finished. But when I'm finished, I will. Just a few more. Never finishes. Oh, Haridas, now I know you never finish, said Maya personified when she came. So this is our focus. Krishna, that's our meditation. Krishna. And how we, yatarbhaka, what is it? Doesn't come. There's a boy who's playing with his own reflection. Pratibimbiyata. A boy who is playing with his own reflection. Krishna playing with his own energies. Krishna. Our meditation is Krishna. 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 Hey. Du kannst richtig auf Deutsch fragen. Ja. Dann werden wir das übersetzen. Da muss auch laut auf Deutsch gemacht werden, weil anders höre ich es nicht. Anders sind es, wenn ich drehe, dann wird es besser.
Ist das gut so? Ja. Zum Thema Verzeihung und Mitgefühl.
Und Mitgefühl.
Mitgefühl wollte ich was fragen. Es gibt einige Turbulenzen bei uns im Namahata. Das kommt wirklich vor. Und Menschen, die mir lieb sind, sind betroffen. Und meine Frage ist, wie kann ich dieses Mitgefühl praktizieren, Leuten gegenüber, die schlecht behandeln, diejenigen, die mir lieb sind. Und wie werde ich nicht kritisieren diese Leute? Und kein Weichnerapparat.
Kein was?
Kein Weichnerapparat.
Weichnerapparat machen.
Es
gibt viele Sachen, die du so aufbringst. She's speaking about a situation in her environment where there are devotees who are going through some turbulence and how can you have a positive response to that, you know, full of in a compassionate mood, but at the same time it can also be complicated, and how do you avoid committing offenses to the devotees? As I say, you painting a situation which has different elements. One element is that there are people who are in trouble. We want to help them. That is our compassionate side. At the same time, we are limited in tolerance, and it gets a little intense helping people with problems, because they suck your energy, and sometimes they are outright agitating to get into people's issues and problems can be overwhelming and can even bring out some aggression, and can even then you could easily fall into Vaishnava apparat. So you speak about all kinds of dynamics and a whole process actually that's taking place. Don't let it go so far that it all the way comes to getting agitated. Stay at the beginning. Here's a situation with turbulence. Can I help? I'd like to, but at the same time I have to protect my own little world of sanity, my own basis of the mode of goodness, where I try to cultivate a transcendental consciousness, that I also have to protect. So I can only absorb so much of all these things before it will disturb me. So yes, my
compassion is there, I'll try to help. But not so much that it starts to really upset the balance in my own environment that I cannot do. I have to protect my own spiritual life also. So there was a little bit, I can give a little bit extra, a little bit, and I feel it also, but too much giving beyond my capacity, it starts to upset my mode of goodness atmosphere from where I try to cultivate my Krishna consciousness, and I'll go down, and I'll get under the lower modes. Now, that cannot happen. So don't let it go that far. Help, but sometimes keep a respectful distance, just out of self-preservation, and to preserve our own little mode of goodness situation where we're trying to cultivate our Krishna consciousness. When you're more advanced and there is more Krishna consciousness, and you're actually inspired in Krishna consciousness, yes, then you can take more of this negative energy. But even then, you know, like, know your limits. Know your limits in how much negative energy you absorb. And remember, some people, they, you know, they need some help. But people have to help themselves. Everyone has to help themselves. This is a process where you got to do it yourself. We can't just be there full of compassion, helping, helping, helping. Some people, they just need to be helped continuously. Never ends. The black hole. It just, more and more energy goes in there and you help, and then they need more help. And then you've helped, and then they need more help until you need help in the end. So, you know, be careful with helping others. Some people, they are addicted to being helped, but they never change. When you help someone, they have to change. If they don't change, stop helping. Cannot be helped now. Leave it to somebody greater than you to help them. Narcissistic people. Yeah. Just absorb my own misery, my misery. My life is just one big boil. Everything goes wrong. I suffer continuously. Everything is just going wrong. Nobody loves me. Nobody cares for me. I have no good qualities. My life, my karma is the worst in the world. I'm just a hopeless case. I mean, what are you going to do? Tell such people. Stop it. Stop it. As Hari Suri used to say. Stop! He has a good way of saying stop. I told you to stop it! So just tell them with that accent, stop it! Help yourself. They're not going to help you. Help yourself. Stop lamenting. One day a week, no lamenting. And then 2 days, and then build it up to 7. Stop lamenting. Anybody else? Question? Yes, put it up.
In Antwerpen was one man, and he got the Bhagavad Gita. And so he read it, and then he saw Prabhupada sitting on a Vyasasan. So what he did, he built himself a Vyasasan, and he was thinking, when I read this book, I have to sit on the Vyasasan. So actually,
well, I also think that.
So it was not out of envy or something, but just ignorance. So some people might read the Krishna book and they see, oh, this Krishna, he's enjoying like this.
Yeah.
So and out of envy, not out of envy, but maybe they think, oh, I have to enjoy also like that.
Well, yeah. I mean, you see children walking around and they say, I'm Krishna. They're playing. You're Krishna. Mother says, no, you're not Krishna. He says, no, I am Krishna. That's us children. Even some adults like that. Yeah, but you know, In the association of the Vaishnavas, that kind of misconception should come down. And when it doesn't come down, then they cannot stay in the association of the Vaishnavas. I mean, there have been situations in temples. In one temple there was a situation when the curtain opened, there was this devotee standing there.
Oh,
really? Yeah, really. True story. Never a dull moment in the Hare Krishna movement. Only some excitement. So these things, in the association of devotees, that quickly has to come down. Yeah. And if it doesn't, then shape up or ship out.
I have another question.
You have another question.
This question is an opinion from the Mataji who wrote me this. And she wrote, Krishna supplies whatever we need, but sometimes we see devotees leave Krishna consciousness because some needs were not met and they lose the strength to continue. Where did that devotee go wrong that he didn't find the strength to continue and take shelter of Maya instead?
Yeah, okay. You know, first of all, you can try to leave Krishna, but Krishna will not leave you. We can walk out of the temple, we can take off these clothes if we wear them, and we can just put on regular clothes, we can slam the door and say goodbye and walk out the gate and, you know, hit the road, Jack, then you never come back. But Krishna is also on the road. Krishna is on the road. Krishna is everywhere. I experienced that myself in the early days of Krishna consciousness. I sometimes became discouraged and left for a few days. So on this occasion, I left for a few days. And then after a few days, I was bored and I went to the movies. And when I went to the movies, suddenly there were these Hare Krishnas in the movie. Like, what's going on? And they had tila, but the tulsi leaf on the nose was missing. So what's going on? These are not real Hare Krishnas. Next moment, these fake Hare Krishnas go into some bar, they sit at the bar, order some beer, some girls sit down on their lap, and I was so angry. Krishna's everywhere. I've tried several times in my life to run away from Krishna. I was in Vrindavan, and during the Govindam prayers, Govindam Adipurusam, and I sneaked out of the back door. Yes. And I went to Benares, because I knew Benares. I was in Benares, and I sit down on the bank of the Ganga, one sadhu comes. He sits next to me. He doesn't say a word. He has an ikatar. And he starts singing Hare Krishna. He doesn't say nothing. He just starts singing Hare Krishna. 45 minutes. Then he stops and he doesn't say goodbye. He just walks away. It's like, whoa. I just escaped and now see what happened. The next morning, I stay in a hotel. The next morning, I come out of the hotel and just go to the street. There's a whole group of Indian people having a Harinam. You're chanting Hare Krishna. They go, this place is bewitched. I'm getting out of here. I thought, where do I go? Then I thought, let me go to the Buddhists. There I have the best chance to escape Krishna.
So I went there.
But Krishna was even there also. On the way, I got dysentery. I went to the Tibetan doctor high up in the mountains because I could barely walk. There was only one seat left in the waiting room. I had to sit down. Next to someone who was yellow like a banana, I said, hope I won't get that. I did get it. I did. I became yellow like a banana. I was finito. I was knocked out. I had to follow the four regulated principles. I was too sick. I couldn't do anything.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Then I had gone back to the Netherlands, you know, I was sick there one day. An old friend comes and he says to me, you know, what I have from Afghanistan. I said, no, I don't take these things. So no. But anyway, he took me in. And I walked down to the letterbox, and there's a letter from Vrindavan, from the temple. And I opened the letter. And this is before email, and the letter says, now that you've left the temple, I'm sure you start again with the intoxication.
I had just started.
Oh my God. Every time I turn away from Krishna, there's something. Krishna was everywhere. He was kind. So, you can escape from Krishna. You can tell that. Krishna is everywhere. Sometimes he lets you believe that you have escaped. But not for long. Many more stories I could tell about this, but the time has moved along, so I'm leaving. Okay. But thank you all for your time. Srila Prabhupada.
Jaya.